on Power Talk AM 1460 and FM 101.1, streaming worldwide on iHeart Radio. Jan Price talks to the movers and shakers in the film business. The Jan Price Show.
You're listening to The Jan Price Show, and today my guest is Emmy-winning voiceover artist Tasia Valenza. Welcome to the show, Tasia.
Oh, thank you so much, Jan. It's a pleasure to be with you.
It's nice to have you. Nice to talk to you in person. I've watched your TED Talk, and very interesting. We're going to get into that a little bit. But since this is our very first show that we're all doing remotely from our homes, since we are all on lockdown, and I would like to, address the elephant in the room. Let's talk a little bit about how the coronavirus is affecting you and your business right now.
Sure. It's definitely interesting in terms of the ironic thing is that I've been working in my studio/closet for 20 years. So that I have been very acclimated to working alone and speaking with people over the phone or digitally and, different devices. So that interestingly did not change for me in the how it is for millions of people and how difficult a learning curve that is. But certainly the business was, the voiceover business, because I have two parts as a teacher and a speaker and as a voiceover artist. As a voiceover artist, what I've noticed, it was like a big dip where, it was just basically no auditions coming in and the work slowed down greatly. And interestingly, at this point, a few weeks in, there's just this incredible pivot where the work is coming in and the auditions are coming back, but they're, it's as if the clients were figuring out, well, how do we approach this now? And so a lot of the spots are very, very supportive and heartwarming. And it's a lot less about sell and a lot more about we're here for you. So that on the voiceover side, that's been an interesting and, of course, appropriate shift. A lot of the speaking that I've been doing in regards to Give Great Voice has become, of course, remote instead of in person. But the interesting part, synchronistically, is that the whole TEDx talk was to really empower the fact that when we use our voices, we can move and touch someone with our voices. Mm-hmm. And I was basically mandating to ring the bell to use our voices to touch and connect with each other. And here we are in this incredibly once-in-a-lifetime, God willing, situation where people are doing just that. So it was kind of this, the timing of it to come out, previous to that, like about a month till this all came out, was just very magical for me. And I feel very blessed that something that's been so important for me to share is really being, if there's any silver lining, that people are connecting with each other in ways that has not happened in a while. So I think that was a much longer answer.
It was
like for the voiceover, because I'm kind of in this duality of like, who am I now? I'm a voiceover artist, and I'm also this, using that skill set to share my passion, which is to teach people how to give great voice more and inspire them.
That's wonderful, and we need that more than ever right now. And I agree with you. I think there's a lot of silver linings that will come out of this if we look for them. They're going to be there for everyone. I totally agree. But I think that the way that we're connecting now is on a deeper level, and it's interesting too, because, I talk to a lot of people in this industry, and, when you see so many people that are so well known that have been affected by this, and they're, posting things, on Twitter and Instagram and Facebook about their experience. And I think that helps everybody else to realize, hey, John Legend's going through this and his wife, and they're not any different, than the rest of us. So I think that also helps that we all are in this together. It's everyone. So
right. That's a rarity. That's never happened. I mean, there's never been a worldwide situation where we're all literally human beings experiencing the same tragedies and challenges. But we're also in a great time of technology where we can see one another and experience it truly together, as opposed to even 10 years ago, we would have been far more isolated in our understanding understanding and being able to share with each other, how are you doing and how are you feeling? And this happened to me, and how can we support one another? So that's, again, such a gift that if it had to happen, thank God we can have the ability to override it by being able through technology to still connect with each other.
Yes, I agree. Well, again, blessings. There's always blessings in it. How did you start your career? How did you wake up one day and say, hey, I want to be a voiceover artist? Or how did that evolve? And how did you, because you do a lot of things, and I do want to get into, well, you can tell everyone, they'll be familiar with your voice.
You've had
a lot of well-known characters, but tell me a little bit, tell our audience how you got into this business.
Sure. Well, I jokingly like to say that I'm a recovering actress and a fully functioning voiceover artist. Actors Anonymous. Hi, my name is Tasia. I used to be an actress, but I started actually on camera when I was 15. I was actually discovered by the late, great Louis Malle, French director.
Oh, wow.
It's kind of one of those fun stories that you have to be of a certain age to know who
he
was.
Louis was married to Candace Bergen, too.
That's correct. Yes. And so people know her. If they don't know him, they know her. Murphy Brown. But I was literally discovered when I was 15 because my mother was an actress previous, and my father really were actors growing up. So I knew that I wanted to be, I kind of came out, you know, screaming my head up and singing, and yeah, I want to be. it was definitely in the genes. And I did every school and camp play, and I was the lead. And then my mom, who wasn't really acting a lot at that point or singing, but she would go to open calls sometimes, and we would do extra work around New York City because I was born and raised there. And she had the opportunity to go for this open call for this film called Crackers. And it was a Latina woman, and I was actually home, ironically, cutting school only that one time, watching all my children. And she went to the open call, and I said, hey, bring my picture. You never know, for extra work. And sure enough, they'd written the wrong age. There were all these ladies there of a certain age, and they said, I'm sorry, ladies, you know, we don't need you. We're looking for an ingenue. And my mom, you know, promptly went to the front of the line and put my picture down and said, like this? And sure enough, I auditioned for Juliet Taylor, who cast all of Woody Allen's films. And she said, you're wonderful. I'm going to send you out to LA tomorrow, and either you'll be back the next day or pack for 6 weeks. So it was kind of crazy and fun. And my mom sent me with one of her friends, and I screen tested with Sean Penn, who was my leading man.
Wow.
But you know, I was hoping for Scott Baio at the time, because of course, all I could think about was Spicoli from Ridgemont High as my leading man. I'm really going to have to be an actress here. He was great and very much in character. And I screen tested, and I got the part and stayed out there and did the film. And it was with Christina Berlansky and Wallace Shawn and Donald Sutherland. I mean, the cast was amazing, and Lee was amazing. So I went from my school play to that. And then I came back. And 6 months later, I got all my children, and almost didn't take that because I was told, you know, you don't go from a soap opera to a movie. I mean, a movie to a soap opera. But I was so in love with it. And I just felt I was the part. And I missed the first screen test. And then I asked my agent what happened. And he said, nobody got it. And I said, well, I think that part is mine. So I want a screen test. And sure enough, I got that. And I did that for 3 years and was nominated for an Emmy for crying really well as Dottie Thornton. And then went on to LA, came out to LA and started doing a work out here, and found my way into voiceover yet again, because my mom said, you should be doing voiceover. And that was like early 90s. And I was like, really thinking, I said, well, it's such a niche business. How am I going to get in? And thankfully, she nagged me so much that I attempted it and found my way in, and then realized what I had never fully understood till that moment, that, you know, and I know you can understand this in every actor, is that I was finally liberated from my body and my face and the confines of, you're a wonderful actor, but you're not enough of this, or you're too much of that. You're not, you know, tall enough or blonde enough, or all the things that we as actors have to face in terms of rejection again and again and again, because it's so much, you know, of you walking and being what they envision. And so as soon as I started doing voiceovers, I was booking so many more jobs, and there was no, like, you know, that question of like, I didn't get the job, but but they loved you. But no, that you just got the job. I mean, I got the job, you know, and I just realized that, wow, I really am gifted in this medium, but now I'm no longer confined to what I look like. And that kind of just set me on fire. And I had about a 6-year crossover and then realized that I wanted to devote myself exclusively to voiceovers, and have been doing that ever since, 20 something years more. So
that's amazing.
That's the evolution of so I've been very, very blessed and very grateful. And I'm glad I had the background of the acting, because it definitely has informed me, because voice acting is still, you know, it's acting and you're just channeling it all through your voice. It's even more challenging in that way, that you don't have the arch of an eyebrow and you don't have your body language. But like I said, the flip side is you're also you're free to express yourself, and whatever you can do with your voice, that's golden. And you're no longer, you know, left to be the physicality of what you look like.
And that's so wonderful, isn't it? To feel that freedom.
It is. It is. You know, as artists, we want to express ourselves, and we want to be affirmed that we have something special to give. And unfortunately, you know, we're fortunate for the very, you know, some of us, again, we it benefits us. And there's always there's a negative on both sides. So for me, I live in the world of voiceover, and it has, not only that, but I love to say that my therapist said that my mental health was going up in proportion to the amount of voiceovers I was doing, which is why I call myself a recovering actress, because truly, you know, I am much more healthy mentally, because, you know, it's very hard to be rejected when it's not your work or a piece of paper. It's you. You're being rejected, essentially. And you can say, well, of course, it's this and that, but it really does, you know, take its toll on you.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I didn't mention this, but I'm also a recovering actress and musician.
Sure,
yeah. And I'm also from New York area. So,
you know exactly what I do.
Yeah. And then I finally got, woke up and said, I'm not that talented. I don't think I'm going to continue with this. I can't handle all that rejection.
Right. Well, it's probably not that you weren't that talented, but it's, you have to have such a drive and such a thick skin, and
yes.
or, you know, where you see a lot of actors that they don't, and then they end up in very, very, you know, challenging, almost, my dog barking, she wants to come in, very challenging, you know, situations where there is that depression and that, you know, that downward spiral because of the ups and the downs in your ego. So, you know, I think both of us made the right decisions.
I know I did, for sure. And I think more importantly, it was, I realized I wasn't that passionate about it. And mm-hmm. in order to be successful in anything, you must be passionate about it. And when I came to terms with that, I said, you know what? I don't really enjoy this that much.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's another path. So, you know, it's always interesting when we can have that self-realization and look at something and go, and stand outside of ourselves and look at
yes.
it and make those kinds of decisions, which is what you did also. So how did you end up? Because I would love to talk a little bit about the female characters that you've mm-hmm. played. Poison
sure.
Ivy,
mm-hmm.
What is it? Shaak Ti?
Shaak Ti, General
Shaak
Ti from the Clone Wars.
Yeah. And Venisa Doza. So how did you get, you had obviously auditioned for that, but
sure.
what was that process like for you? And is that something you really enjoy a lot, playing those kinds of characters?
Yeah, I've been very blessed as a voiceover artist that I've pretty much dipped my lip into every medium. And that's the beauty of voiceovers, too, is that there's commercial and narration and promos and political and radio imaging and then animation. These are all areas that I have been blessed to be able to work in. But of course, as soon as I was able to do my first animated character, I was really back home, you know, because the other ones, you're a storyteller, but now to be able to be, you know, really fully committing to a character again, even though it's animated, it's a blessing, because there I am acting again. And the range of characters that I've played have primarily been very strong female characters, and or, you know, seductive versions, or Poison Ivy is known, you know, as a seductress. And of course, in all of the iterations villains ever. She's a wonderfully multifaceted villainess slash, I think, Shiro in terms of, you know, her passion is for her plants. And those are her, you know, she's mother to all nature. And so she can be conceived as a very one-dimensional, but if you really look at her, she's really trying to protect her young. And I love playing her because she's such an iconic DC, you know, character that's been around and been played by so many wonderful actresses. But I got to play her in the 3 Arkham series games, and they were very popular. And people have been really generous in extolling that I kind of, you know, nailed her seductive qualities and yet her strength. And then Shaak Ti is the, you know, the polar opposite and yet very strong. She's a Jedi, so much cooler than I'll ever be. And to be part of the that's the beautiful thing about being an actor, is like you can literally like upgrade your own self because you get a chance to play these amazingly powerful characters that you in real life you would never get to. And I feel like it, each one that I play, they leave a little bit of their imprint on me and make me a better person. And so to be part of the Star Wars world, you know, growing up with that was just a gift. And she's a Jedi, so she's this really, you know, much more authoritative and calm. And again, you know, I think of intention when I play the character, and my voice follows that intention. So, so you know, for Poison Ivy, it's to seduce and then kill. And then for Shaak Ti, it's to enhance and to secure and to make, you know, basically be a general, but a Jedi, you know, the force channeling with you, calm general that can give her people, you know, and her forces the power they need to go out and be courageous. So again, the voice follows the intention. And then Venisa, who was also in the Star Wars universe in Star Wars Resistance, was kind of the closest to me as a human, because she's the only out of those two characters. And so, and I've also played Sniper Wolf in Metal Gear Solid, which has a very big following. But Venisa is a rare Star Wars figure in that she's a mother and an incredibly courageous captain, kind of Han Solo-esque, very, you know, very flamboyantly confident, but really grounded fighter. And she's also happens to be a mother. So that was really a great gift to be able to play her, because she, again, far more courageous than I'll ever be, but also very emotionally connected to her family. And it was beautiful for me as a mother of 3 to be able to enter her heart and be connected to her.
All very uniquely different women and very powerful in their own way. If you're just tuning in, my guest today is Emmy-winning voiceover artist Tasia Valenza. Did I say it right? Valenza?
Tasia.
Oh my God. I said, yeah. Here I go.
That's okay. You know what? We'll just go right back to Fantasia. The audience doesn't know, but I was amazingly, my parents were such actors, you know, that they named me from Fantasia and were kind enough to leave off the fan. So so everybody could just, we'll just sink into that, but no way.
Yeah, sorry about that.
Doesn't matter what you call me, just call me, right? Isn't that your guy?
Well, speaking of calling you, I'd love to talk. I want to talk a little bit about your TED Talk that you have, and it's called Give Great Voice. I want to know how that came about, how you ended up doing the TED Talk, and get into a little bit more details when you talk about Give Great Voice.
Of course. So the TEDx Talk was something that I was, something in my mind like 7 years ago. I said, you know, I think the world is really, really interested in voiceover, and the idea that all the skill sets that I've learned as a voiceover artist and as an actress by breaking down characters all the time, seeing who they are and their characteristics, and then how they relate to the world and each other, which is, you know, the 4 questions, you know, who am I in the scene of my life? Who am I speaking to? What do I want? And how does my voice support that intention? I noticed the same things that allowed me to be really successful as a voiceover artist, understanding those questions every time I break down a script and play a character, I could also apply in my real life and be a better mother for that, and be a better wife and friend and daughter, and all the roles that I play, along with, of course, the 30 years of therapy and emotional intelligence, those things very much. But I really wanted to share how you know, our voices matter so much. And if I can share how I've used the skill set of being a voiceover artist to play those roles and then help other people to take the same skill sets and apply it in their roles, it would make me feel really purposeful. And so it kind of evolved from much more of a superficial of, you know, at that time I had these teenagers that were doing so much upbeat and mumbling and all the things. And I would go to, and college kids, you know, really loved my character. So I was going to go to colleges and share, you know, hey, you're going out into the world and you need to utilize your voice in order to get the interview and the job and digital communication was taking over more and more and more. But by the time I did the talk, which was just November and it came out in February, you know, it was more of a holistic approach because I've also made an affirmation meditation app, and that's completely free, called Haven, of Give Great Voices a holistic. First, it's how do we speak to ourselves, our self-speak? So many of us will tear ourselves down before we build ourselves up. So that's a component that's so important to give great voice, to move and touch someone, including ourselves. And then to go out and use that same skill set of how we play our roles more successfully by thinking like a voiceover actor. And then the last one is to kind of remind everyone that our voice with a loving intention trumps any emoji any day, and that we must continue to use our voices to connect with the people we love. So that's that. This evolution of what Give Great Voice became this TED Talk, and became something that I was really honored to give, and has taken on a life even far greater than I expected, because I thought at that time I was really going to have to ring the bell. The train had left. Digital communication was, you know, forever going to be taking place, and phone calls were going to be, you know, antiquated things of the past. And, you know, since this COVID-19 situation, that has definitely changed. And again, the silver lining that this talk, which I was hoping will inspire, has definitely taken on even greater. And it's more important than ever, since we physically can't even touch each other anymore, to be able to use our voices and our faces to give great voice and great love to one another.
I agree. Couldn't be more perfect. And it is perfect timing here for it also. I want to talk a little bit about your meditation, Haven, your meditation app that you have. Because that's also perfect for what's going on in the world today, too. Do you want to talk a little bit about what that is exactly and how people can get that app?
Absolutely, yes. One of the journeys as a voiceover artist, I got to get involved and co-found this affirmation meditation app. And initially, I was just going to be a voiceover artist, and I found the idea beautiful, but the content itself was very lacking for me, because I definitely have been in my evolution as a human being, you know, affirming myself to have more self-kindness, and you know, affirmations have been around forever, but not always utilized, you know, in a way that can help us really tap into that deeper part of ourselves, because when we meditate, we're so much more receptive. So long story short, I got to become a co-founder of it and co-wrote each one, and they're basically, it's similar to Calm and Headspace, and it's an app that's broken down into different chapters, masteries are called, and 7 days of confidence, 7 days of stress reduction, 7 days of depression support, addiction support, and marriage, leadership, different, and health, wealth, and they're all literally just my voice with guiding you through a lovely thought for the day, and then some beautiful deep breathing, diaphragmatic breathing, which really helps to relax the nervous system. And then in a calm and relaxed state, saying kind and loving things to ourselves. It's completely free. And it's something that I offer as a Be Kind to Our Mind app, which I think we need more than ever because of this universal state of anxiety. So it's called Haven Guided Affirmations. You can find it at either Google or the App Store. And as I mentioned, it's completely free. There's no strings. And it's just a gift that I offer so that we can use it to be kind to ourselves, say kind things to ourselves. And then when we have that more relaxed state and more filling ourselves with a little bit more relaxation and positive statements, we have so much more bandwidth and to give it to those around us.
Beautiful, beautiful. And the timing again is absolutely perfect. Thank you for the gift of you. I've really enjoyed our conversation today, Tasia. Thank you.
I so appreciate you letting me have this time with you to share about these passions of mine. And I hope everyone will take care of themselves and take care of each other and love each other and know that we'll get through this. And please give great voice to one another. That's what we can do now. And it's so important.
What a beautiful message. Definitely. Thank you. And you stay safe. Stay safe.
You too.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. You can listen to the Jam Price Show all about movies anywhere, anytime on the iHeart Radio Podcast Network, on Spotify, Google Podcast, Apple Podcast, YouTube, and on your smart TV. Also, you can go to thejampriceshow.com to listen to archived shows and the Price Movie Minute movie reviews. Thank you for listening.
On Power Talk AM 1460 and FM 101.1, streaming worldwide on iHeartRadio. Jan Price talks to the movers and shakers in the film business. The Jan Price Show.